designated day, so I thought I'd come back today. No, that's not true. You know, I like you when I was young. I spent a lot of time with the sun, scuba diving, camping, lifeguarding, and the sun. What happens now? All the elderly people are paying the price. Besides that, I think my dermatologist wanted to go skiing. So he had to make a little money, so he said, let me cut on you, so he had to cut out the people. So I apologize for that. Hope it doesn't distract you. It's no real big deal, other than when you have to put your glasses on, things like that. So I appreciate you inviting me here tonight, in spite of my condition. I really am so thrilled that Capstone Man really brought this program again. And I'm very, very pleased to see so many women here tonight, because you probably know the issue of men more than men know themselves. Let me give you a disclaimer first. I'm not an intellectual. I'm not a researcher. I'm a practitioner. I'm not a person who's authored lots of work about the male species. But I've done a lot of collecting of articles, and I've done a lot of observations. And I've learned a lot about three sons and a daughter. And when you have three sons and a daughter, you can compare the three sons to the daughter, you get some very big comparisons. Because you also get with each son and each daughter a geometrically expanded family of their friends. So I have had, for the past 20 years, I've had in my household hundreds and hundreds of young men and young women, all associated with my family. So I really appreciate the fact that we can get together and listen to you for 34 minutes tonight. Break into the group maybe and have some further discussions. You distributed questions, right? There's some questions distributed that kind of are interesting questions. And the reason I wanted those questions to go out was because I was asking people to design some. But, you know, you're going to do two things if you participate in the series that I really love. One is you're going to have an opportunity to stimulate your thinking about things that you don't really take the time to think about. You know, sometimes when things are difficult, we try to avoid it. About. This is sometimes very difficult for some of us because this is our own identity development. This is our personal development. This is who we are, who we want to become. So it's a little difficult to have these difficult tasks and be stimulated to think about things, but you're going to engage in dialogue. And dialogue is one of my favorite words because it's a process of making meaning. And hopefully, through the course of some discussion you'll engage in, you will make the meaning. That'll be wonderful for you. You've heard of the achievement gap, probably. Have you heard of the gender gap? I don't know if people believe there's a gender gap or not, but is there a problem with the enrollment, retention, and academic performance of men? Is there an engagement gap that's different between men and women regarding the amount of time that men and women spend in education and personal activities, both in the classroom and beyond the classroom? Is there an engagement gap between the time that men spend engaging in their own self-development compared to that of women? Let me stop and say, I don't want you to think this is a male bashing session. Not. But in all the literature you read, one of the things that becomes apparent is that society, and that's your parents and my peers, and many people that are of your age, don't believe there's a difference in sex or there's a difference in behavioral patterns. And so what I'm going to do tonight is try to demonstrate to you there may be, and then leave it up to you all to try to figure out what you might want to do about it. So is there a gender gap between men and women in terms of bad behavior? In terms of disruptive behavior, in terms of self-destructive behavior, there actually is a pretty huge gap. You know what's sad? The gap is apparent between women and men. When women gain their independence, they start to adapt to the habits, some of the bad habits of men. We're worried about that. So I'm excited about this for another reason. That is that I hope you'll engage in some discussion among yourselves, not about the life stage that you're in the college student, but the lifestyle you want over a period of time. Because one of the things we like to do in college help you learn good habits in the head and the hand and the heart. And that's what our goal will be through this program. So, do we really have a male crisis? I don't want you to raise your hand, but I want you to have to commit to your peers. Do we have a male crisis in our society today? Are males in decline and stagnant? Are males losing ground to women? Let's just look at a small sampling of articles that I gathered just over the past couple of years. And this was one from Newsweek, by the way. If you have the last issue of Newsweek, you know, the entire print one is only digital. So every Newsweek article I have, every day I try to keep. This is one called Man Up. The traditional male is an endangered species. It's time to rethink masculinity. Here's one from The Atlantic, one of my favorite magazines. The End of Men. The subtitle is How Women Are Taking Control of Everything. And they are. This is an article by George Will. You know George Will? Columnist, and conservative columnist. He's writing about the plight of young men who, he says, are increasingly reluctant to grow up. The Pew Research shows that 28% of wives between the age of 30 and 44 have more education than their husbands today. In fact, in some age groups, they're making more money than their husbands. Here's a startling thing. In 1956, the median age of men married was 22. By 2004, at the age of 40, many men are still not married. Listen to this. A recent study found that 55% of men aged 18 to 24 are living in their parents' homes. 55%. That there are 13 of men 25 to 34, but compared to only 8% of women. And Gary Cross's book, Where Have All the Men Gone? Men to Boys, the Making of Modern Immaturity, he says the culture of boys and men today is less a life stage than a lifestyle. And in fact, it's illustrated by, I've never heard of this chain before, but have you ever heard of Dave and Buster's? Oh, yeah. You know, I've never been to one of these, but Dave and Buster's is a place for young adults to face the men, to drink beer, to play electronic games, and to exemplify and memorialize youth. Not as a stage of life, but as a perpetual refuge from adulthood. And here's the most damaging thing that I think that, that George Will said. He said, a year ago, when Tiger Woods' misadventures became public, his agent said, let's please give the kid a break. The kid was 33, now 35, but no doubt he's probably still a kid. Kind of sad commentary. Here's one that you women will appreciate, I think. This is from the Wall Street Journal. And it's called The Right Man Is Getting Harder to Find. And it goes on to say that this is kind of interesting. There's been a 145% rise in unmarried births among college-educated women. Unmarried births among college-educated women, which is twice the increase among an unmarried births among women without a college education. And that's just births. It doesn't include adoptions. And why is that? Because the new reality is that women are becoming better educated and more preferred than men in the workplace. And as unsettling as that is, it started to become intimidating to men. Here's an attribute from a woman. She says, I found a lot of Mr. Almost, but I can't find Mr. Right. I've been dating forever and can't find the right guy. When I bring people back to my home, I've got a four-bedroom home, they comment about my success. Oftentimes when they come home, they want to know about my salary, my educational advantage, because I have an advanced degree. And the final blow comes when I tell them about the awards I've won for my volunteer work in the Kansas City area. To be honest, I'm telling them about my life, but I feel like they're telling me my life is too good for them. I'm too good for them. I'm intimidating them. That's never my intention. So it says, all this leaves single women, such as this, just don't name the person, facing unwelcome choices. Going to a sperm-based method is definitely not my first choice, and I'm not willing to give up my dream of having a child just because I can't find Mr. Right. And I have to realize that my fairy tale dream may be inverted. And it was interesting because I had a group of friends at my house over Christmas, and there was a young woman, 25 years old. She'd been dating this guy for about a year, and my daughter and I said, oh, well, this must be Mr. Right. It just was this thing. She said, you're kidding. No, this is not Mr. Right. She said, this is my temporary dude. So, you know, I'm not going to settle for this. I mean, I'm thinking to myself, wow, you act like you're flawed, you act like this is the love of your life. But she's got a standard that this young man can't meet. Here's another article about the mysterious decline of where are men on campus. It says, this is kind of sad to me. When boys are unable to fit into a school environment that's clearly not suited to them, they're often diagnosed with attention deficit disorder. And they're given Ritalin or other drugs. Nearly 9 million prescriptions of Ritalin are written for American children each year, almost all of them boys between the ages of 6 and 12. According to Tom Sowell, who wrote the book Inside American Higher Education, The Decline, The Deception, The Dogma, the drugging of boys is a part of the growing tendency to treat boyhood as a pathological condition that requires the three new R's, repression, re-education, and Ritalin. Used to be the motto was boys will be boys. Today the motto seems to be boys will be medicated. This is an article about gents, jerks, and jocks. Anybody want to be stereotyped as a social context that we see interact. What are we doing in college that has kind of an influence on young males that we see? Because here's what the article says. We know that nearly all acts of violence, sexual assaults, sexual harassment occurred on university campuses are committed by male students. We also know that male students constitute the overwhelming majority of students who were cited for non-academic violations. And they go on to say that educators on college campuses should be mindful of ways to get men to step out of their cultural comfort zone and spend time with men of different ethnicities, religions, sexual orientations, and abilities. And how many men will do that? Maybe if a petition is right, they will. This is from the Men's Center at Johns Hopkins and the University of Oregon co-authored this article that says, college men's health is in crisis, yet men are reluctant to seek mental health services. College men are in the middle of a health crisis. 86% of the suicides committed by men. 86% is a national epidemic of suicides of men. Men engage in more frequently in risky and violent sexual behavior at higher rates of drug and alcohol use, and more likely to commit a campus shooting. Y'all heard of the book Guyland? Get rid of Guyland. You might think it's a kind of funny book, but in part it talks about how young men oftentimes have an inability to have healthy relationships with women. They have murky career goals, and they have a desire not to grow up. They are directionless drifters, is how he classifies men. It's kind of like when I left college, I had the same friends with the same aimless goals. Guyland is the world in which young men live, both the stage of life and an undefined time span between adolescence and adulthood that can often stretch for a decade or more. And a place, or rather a bunch of places, where guys gather to be guys with each other, unhassled by the demands of authority, parents, girlfriends, jobs, or kids, and the other nuisances of adult life. Young men shrink the responsibilities of adulthood and remain fixated on the trappings of boyhood, while the boys they are strive heroically to prove that they are real men despite all contrast, evidence of contrast. This is from Esquire, and it says, there's actually a problem we've ignored for too long, and that is that there is an evidence of male achievement and ambition deficits that we see in our children that we must engage, that we must address by having them, by addressing their record of failure and disengagement. And he goes on to say that I spent hours watching my boys watch reruns of Jackass. You ever seen that? Of course, everybody's seen that. And here's what he said after. I watched it. As I watched them, and I watched every social problem was laid at the feet of my male son. Sexual violence, binge drinking, anti-intellectualism, homophobia, bullying. On the whole, boys don't seem focused to me, and they seem a whole lot dimmer in their past from watching things like this. Did you know that colleges and universities actually are doing affirmative action for men? This is an article that says many colleges are rejecting women at rates practically higher than those for men, so they'll keep a balance in favor of men. Women are becoming more and more qualified. Now, just for the sake of balance, this was an article in the New York Times just recently, and it's the myth of the male decline. This author says, how can we say there's a decline in men? Men still control the most important industries, especially technology. They occupy most of the positions on the list of the wealthiest Americans, and they continue to make more money than women who have similar skills and education. And if men are in decline, why do women make up 17% of Congress? Only 17%. Well, why is that? It's because that's four generations ago. And the people that are in those positions are in their 60s and 70s, right? Your generation, how is it going to look in 10 years, 20 years? That's going to be your legacy when you get there. Here's kind of a summary. Men in higher education suffer from under-engagement, under-enrollment, and under-performance, leading to retention and graduation rates noticeably lower than those of female students. All men, regardless of income, are suffering from lack of engagement. Men are significantly less likely to take a leadership position on campus, to join a student group, to volunteer for community service, to participate in study abroad programs, to use mentoring or academic advising programs. They are significantly more likely to break campus rules, partake in business dangerous activities, commit violent acts against themselves and others, and go on academic probation. Traditional ideas about masculinity appear to be a major impediment to engagement. And social prestige among male comes from exhibiting the typical negative male behaviors. So you say to yourself, well, that's just in general, it's that way at the University of South Carolina. And in fact, it is. So let me just give you some examples of some statistics that illustrate those same numbers at the University of South Carolina. And in general, the higher education, because, you know, for years, men outnumber women in college and university, but now, for every 2 men to get a degree, 3 women get one. Part of the population size, part of that more men are dropping out, more women are going to college, more women succeed. Why do men find themselves in such a good discussion and disbelief, and sometimes even ridicule? Let's look at some of these numbers and see. Females study more hours than do men, about 10% more on average. International education to study abroad at the University of South Carolina, only 29% of our students who study abroad are male. Only about 40% of our Magellan scholarships are male. So who's engaged in undergraduate research? Females. Only about 43% of those students who go to supplemental instruction were male. Even though if you look at the grade point average of all males compared to all females, males are low. Males are more likely to lose their scholarships. Males more likely to go on probation. In the list of bad behaviors, 58% of our referrals to our academic recovery program were male. You know, our academic recovery program is for those students who don't make satisfactory progress in the semester or headed towards academic advancement. So if we try to intervene and save that student from failing out of college, 58% of them were male. Of our total judicial violations in a 3-year period, 68% to 75% in that 3-year period of our judicial violations were by male. 75% of people written up judicial violations were male. Another indicator, only 27% of our male students participated in community service. Only 27%. Y'all, how many of y'all do dance marathon? And if you go to dance marathon, you look at how many males are less than 5%. Thousand people, less than 5%. How many people participated in MLK? Again, predominantly women. And why is that important? Are there gains to be made intellectually, personally, in your own development, understanding the world around you, understanding your purpose, meaning, understanding who you are, if you engage in undergraduate research, community service, or study abroad? Yes, absolutely. That's why we worry about men not being involved. Further, men don't get involved in career service. They underutilized by men. They don't engage in the health of industry as we talked about. Unprotected sex. Every category drinking, consumption, frequency, intoxication, transport, or men. Although I have to tell you that we're seeing more and more women being transported for alcohol overdose as well. Which again is worrisome because if women gain the privilege of men, they're definitely some really bad habits. But the good thing that women start to think about this, so you can start to hold yourself accountable too. Men enter the University of South Carolina with about a 16-point higher SAT, but graduate at a lower rate than women. In fact, our African-American people graduate at the highest value of any of our students. We see distinct patterns of disengagement, moral dilemmas, males being disconnected, and now we're starting to see things where people just call themselves lazy. See, I'm lazy, I have to do this, I'll get by. And they want to get by with their schoolwork by doing it effortlessly. And then there's the whole addiction of gaming. I've got some of this game where you have some kind of control, but a lot of people are actually addicted to it, seduced by the whole game. Here's the one that really worries me. Honors and awards, 78% of our honors and awards generally go to women. 78%. Men tell us that they just don't want to take the time to fill out the application. It's a lot of work. You know, there's a real benefit to filling out the application for awards because it makes you back and think and look at what you've done and what experience you've had. That's what we're moving to with these electronic portfolios. Article in the Wall Street Journal talked about the mom's voice syndrome and how horrible it is that a father to teach your daughter to change an oil in a car or to do any other kind of masculine activity, and that's progressive. But if a mother teaches a son to express his emotion, he's mom's voice. Why do we share that in people that way? Why is this? What's wrong with this? We must together start to create educational opportunities for this kind of dialogue where the knowledge is gained, where new male rules and lifestyles are established for male students. What about spirituality and religion? who goes to church, who goes to hospital, who just pays the bills, thank you. He said, oh, you ought to do. But you know what? Overwhelmingly, keep it during the college years. You know, a lot of college students divorce themselves in their spiritual or their religious activities during college. They've been that way for years. And then as they become adults and they have children and get married, they kind of re-end back to their spiritual life. And then you see a bunch of churches, you know, say the older folks who come back and they're not mature as men and women. But today's world, more women going to church, Bible studies than are men. We need to create, reinforce our male's ability to assume responsibility for their own attributes, their beliefs, and behaviors, and give them permission and empowerment to grow as a person. We need to have other males and females hold them accountable. We need to break the mold and the conflicts that young men have where they feel like they have to conform to traditional masculinity characteristics, where they have to have that kind of an identity, where they have to engage in control, and have the negative consequences of that control. You know the one phrase that I hate, and I mentioned it one time before, and that is that boys will be boys. I can't tell you the number of parents that call when a young man is in trouble, and the first thing they say to me is, well, it's not really a serious trouble, because you know, boys are just going to be boys. And I said, well, you know, he sold a kilo of cocaine. I think maybe, you know, that's not just boys being boys, you know? But what happens is, even if someone is in a tailgate, you can go fight it, and says, you know, boys will be boys. Yeah, but you broke the person's jaw, he had plastic surgery. You know? Boys will be boys. She said yes. She didn't say no. She didn't rape her. Boys will be boys. I just, it's one of the most unfavorite things that parents call me and they say, boys will be boys. My second thing is when they say, what can I do to fix it? And I say, well, maybe you can fix it. You can have your child call up the judicial office and go in and do it. I'll tell you, you can't do much for it. But boys will be boys is an indication, it's kind of a sign of resignation. It's an unapologetic, almost celebration of acceptance that this is the way things should be. And they shouldn't be. They should not be. The students, young males shouldn't be directional drifters. Do we want to have our males labeled this way? Do you want to be labeled that way as a male? Do we want to accept that our brains, males, our brains, our chemistry, are propelled by testosterone or some other wiring because we're playing games that will make us be boys? Are we boys ultimately unchanging in a status state, or even worse, are we declining as wage earners, as husbands, as partners, as fathers, as leaders? The answer is, according to all statistics and everyone we look at, yes. Can we do a better job for our males? Can our males do a better job for themselves? And surely they can. What's the answer? I don't know if there's a real answer, but you are part of the answer. Part of it is people always ask me, they say, why do students drink on a college campus? You've got to be the core education. You can teach them the impact and effect of drugs on the campus. You need to help them understand what alcohol does to their mind. You need to help them understand they lose the fact to make decisions for themselves and bad things happen. You need to do a better job of educating them. And my response is, you know what? You all, you students, are a lot brighter than your parents would be equipped. They underestimate how much you know. You know a lot. Not what you don't know. It's your ability to act on it. Self-discipline to act on it. Motivation to act on it. And I have constantly said, people constantly say, well, I don't think the young people know the difference between right and wrong. You know the difference between right and wrong. You do. Sometimes you're in a period of rebellion, sometimes you're in a period of growth, sometimes you're in a period of giving yourself permission to try and do things you can't do at any other time in your life. This is your time to try, to experiment, to see, and to reconfirm who you are as a person. And some of that requires some limitations. But here's what might happen. If we can create a safe space and give men and women time to feel comfortable with expression, to seek out and provide pathways for their expression, if we can listen without judging, if we can avoid shaming, if we can give affirmation and affection, if we can have every individual engage in difficult dialogue, both with others and with themselves. One of my favorite quotes from John Gardner. John Gardner says, you know, the one thing that keeps us from our own growth is we are our own prisoners in our own selves, but we have the keys. You have the keys. You have the keys to make a difference. Thank you, Pastor Men, for putting this program together. I want to thank you all for coming tonight. And I want to thank you all for taking seriously the plight of man and trying to make this world a little bit better by one by one trying to change yourself, trying to change your fear, trying to change your prayer. Thank you. Now, you applaud. I go out there and I defend you and that whenever, I don't care what goes wrong, who's in trouble, I'm out there trying to find the silver lining for it. And so when I come in and talk to the group and it starts to sound like it's such a downer, it's a little bit of reality. And, you know, reality is the way things are, and the romantic view of life is the way things ought to be. And that's one of the things we always try to do, is take things from the way they are, the way they ought to be. We ought to take that romantic view. If we're externally university, that's what I do, is get romantic view. I sell you as the next generation that we are so lucky to have you. So please don't take anything I said tonight as being discriminatory or defamatory. You know, I simply want you to realize that there are issues out there and here's the solution. Anybody have any questions or comments, or anybody want to comment on any questions that were circulating?